Hello, I'm Bill McKeeth, and this is Snapshot, a collection of conversations with musicians in Southern Idaho. And today our guest is Charlie Simmons. Charlie, welcome.
Glad to be here.
Charlie, tell me a little bit about how you got started in music. Like, we can kind of put together a little historical component to what got us here and so forth.
Well, I grew up in a musical family. My dad was a classical violinist. Played in the symphonies wherever we lived. When I was about 4 years old in Michigan, he also played guitar, and he had me taught me a lot of songs. He'd have me sing, he'd play guitar, and we traveled quite a bit. You know, we had relatives in North Dakota, Minnesota, Montana, and wherever we'd go, you know, there'd just be a big get together, and he'd stand me up on a chair and play the guitar and have me sing. And mm-hmm. I knew all the words to Abdullah Bulbul Amir, you know, back when I was 4 and 5.
So you're 5 years old or 4 and 5?
Yeah, but I just loved the sound of the guitar. I'd get it out when he wasn't home and just put it upside down and sit down, put my ear against it and plunk the strings, you know. But after we'd moved to Portland, I think I was probably like 6 years old, he started giving me violin lessons. And then we moved here to Boise when I was 7. And I took lessons for probably 3 years. But then I enjoyed it at first, but then he started wanting me to play nothing but classical music. And he gave me a full-size violin at the time. I started on a 3/4 and mm-hmm. then the bigger violin, and then this classical music, to me, it was just terrible, boring. I hated it. Mm-hmm. And I struggled with it for a while, and I finally rebelled, you know. I just, if he'd had me, and he could fiddle, if he'd taught me some fiddle tunes, I think I'd have stayed with it. But by that time, I was listening to the Grand Old Opry, you know, and mm-hmm. just loved the sound of banjos and guitars and the singing. And
wasn't quite the same as classical violin, huh?
No. I do wish I'd stayed with it a while, though, because mm-hmm. I would have learned, in another couple of years, I'd have learned more about musical theory than it took me most of my lifetime to learn on my own.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, Charlie, tell me what some of the early influences were on the banjo. You mentioned that was a love of yours.
Yeah, where I played 4 and 5 string, you know, in the 4 string, they were mostly popular in the 20s, you know. They still mm-hmm. were being heard a lot in the country. The early swing bands, Bob Wills and all of them, they all used inner banjo. And so Smokey Montgomery, which played with Bob Wills and the different people, and then 5 string on the Grand Ole Opry, Grandpa Jones, which is still one of my all-time favorites, string being. And then in the 4 string, there was Harry Reeser. I had some of his recorders. He's probably the greatest banjo player of all time, most people say. But anyway, then I heard a recording by Earl Scruggs. And that was like a religious experience. I just thought, how does he do that? So I bought a record of his, and I think I wore the thing out. But I couldn't find anything that taught. I knew he was playing with finger picks and doing the rolls, but I couldn't imitate it.
It was like magic, wasn't it?
Yeah. But I finally did. He came out with a book, Earl Scruggs and the 5-string banjo, and so I sent away for one of those, and that was like my Bible. So I still play most of the tunes that he had in that book, you know. And, but I still love 5 and 4-string banjo. I just like the sound and the different kinds of music you can get with them.
Mm-hmm. They're versatile.
Yeah. And I know it's a big love of yours, you know.
Well, I have a reputation.
The louder, the better, you know.
The louder, the better on a banjo, yes. I have a banjo.
Really?
Yeah, everybody thinks I don't, but
I have
it
in the attic? Have it in the attic or?
No, actually, it's in pieces. I took it apart to refinish it. I haven't got it back together yet, polishing all of the pieces. But So when you play in public, what are the influences on what you choose to play? What do you decide to play?
Oh, I just, whatever kind of music or musicians I'm playing with, I can sit in with most any group, you know, any kind of music, and depending on what they need, I can play electric guitar or acoustic or mandolin, tenor and five-string banjo, harmonica.
I have noticed that. You have a lot of depth with not only instruments, but the kinds of songs.
Yeah.
And the.
In fact, harmonica was when I started learning it when I was just a kid, you know, and I'd save my money and I'd be down at the music store looking at all the new harmonicas to come in, and as soon as I could afford one, I'd buy another one. And so I had all the different keys and all the different models. And I entered a talent contest, a variety show one time they had down at the Ada Theater, which is the Egyptian Theater now. It was on the radio, and I won it playing harmonica. So I say that was the peak of my career, and it's been downhill ever since.
Yeah, well, you went from the harmonica to the banjo, so I guess I couldn't agree more. So what about writing songs? Do you write songs?
I used to some, and I even recorded a couple, but it's something I just never felt I had the time or had an urge to really do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just.
And how is technology and the changes in electronics and so forth, has that affected your music much? Or
terrific changes, you know, when early years when I started playing with some friends, I met a guitar player, a terrific chord man, and we started playing up in Idaho City on weekends, banjo and guitar. And I was playing five string and four string, and we were the first ones, I think, in the area to learn dueling banjos when it was so popular.
Mm-hmm.
And we'd go up there on the weekend, and people would be waiting outside the door waiting for us to play that, you know, and I couldn't believe it, you know. Just So I'd wait till second or third set, you know, so they didn't all go home.
Sure.
But the technology, we were just playing acoustic for quite a while. We just play for beer and tips. And then I bought a microphone and a little Fender amplifier. So we had one mic. And so then I was thinking, boy, really
big
getting
time.
Into big time now.
Yeah.
And so those are some of the most fun times, you know. Three of us from the band and a drunk or two from the bar all standing around one mic singing. Don't get any better than that.
No, that's it. Yeah.
But then after I formed a band, out of that group, we started getting jobs here in town at the Moose Lodge and different wedding receptions, what all and stuff. So I kept getting a little more equipment, and we finally ended up buying a really nice custom sound system with column speakers, and we paid for it with tips we were making. We were playing regularly at the Ponderosa Gun Club, which used to be out south of town, and so we paid for the sound system by playing there. And from there on, we just kept getting more jobs, playing regular at the Legion Hall, and I was called it the animal circuit. We played for all the, like the elks and the moose and the lions and
eagles.
Yeah. Eagles, yeah.
Yeah.
But to start out with, I was trying to keep playing some bluegrass tunes in the old time, and then the people were wanting to dance more, so it finally got, I'd try to keep one set for doing that, and I finally felt, well, I'm annoying them with some of this music, so we pretty much started playing straight dance music and the popular music of the time and the old standards, and we got to be one of the premier bands in the area, probably playing for that sort of thing. We played the singles dances down at the Mardi Gras and a lot of different places.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. By then I was playing electric guitar mostly, but one of the band members also played mandolin, so we'd always do some songs where we had, he was great on harmonizing, so we'd do quite a few tunes with the two mandolins and then throw mm-hmm. in a banjo tune every once in a while, you know. So it was a fun group. Mm. That was the Rocky Mountain Express. Mm.
I know that you had the Boise Banjo Band. Is that still going on?
Yeah, it's still going. In fact, mm-hmm. we're playing this Friday, and Boyd's a member of it.
Oh, is he? Uh-huh.
Yeah, he's a fine banjo player. Mm-hmm. And we've, with that group, we used to put on a big show over in Caldwell for 25 years where the banjo bands had come in from all over the country. Now some of us still go to down California and over to Tacoma, puts one on in Shelton, Washington. And, mm-hmm. But as a band, we used to go to Seattle and down in California and Montana and all these different places. And these bands come to our thing and we'd go to theirs, you know. And mm-hmm. At one time, I probably had 20 members, you know.
I've seen it perform when there were a lot of banjos.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think I've even played with it before. I played that.
Oh, you did. You played with us. Yeah, mm-hmm. you did. Yeah. Yeah, I had a guitar mm-hmm. banjo, you know. Yeah. Yeah, you played it a while. Daryl Watson played it a while, and I sold it to Gary Eller here.
Oh, did you?
A couple of years ago.
Yeah. What advice do you have for people just starting out in the music business? You have any thoughts about that?
Oh well, I agree with what Boyd said. Don't get discouraged. Stay with it. And one thing I would mention, especially you know, with stringed instruments like guitars. Get the best instrument you can afford. It's a lot better now than when I was young. You know, they have some really good instruments coming out of China that
aren't too much money. Yeah.
No, they're not too much money, and the action's pretty good on them. But mm-hmm. when I was first playing guitar, this old guitar my dad had, it was a Sears Silvertone, and mm-hmm. by that time the neck had crept up on it where the strings were so high it just killed your fingers.
Yeah.
So I learned, you know, some first position chords, and I was downtown one day and they're having some kind of a celebration where they're square dancers, and this guy playing guitar, he had a big archtop Gibson guitar that just, I couldn't believe the way that sound boomed out, you know, and he was playing all over the neck, and I thought, well, you can't play guitar up the neck like that.
Your hands can't stand it.
So yeah. I went on break, I went up and looked at his guitar, and here the strings were low all the way up, and so that was an awakening to me. So I started looking for a better guitar.
Mm-hmm.
But with young people, you know, hang in there, and it's whether you do it just as a hobby, you know, or it's always more fun to play with somebody, whether you ever play in a band or not, or by yourself. It's just very worthwhile, and it's a great stress reliever, if nothing else.
It certainly is. And I guess I find it's always better if I can find people better than me to play with.
Well, that's what I was going to bring out, too. You know, I have played with, like I've been up at Weezer, you know, like I remember walking around to the fiddle player, and I saw a friend of mine that terrific swing guitar player, and I said, oh, let's go play. He said, oh, I can't play with him, he's too good. And I said, that's what you want to do, play with these people that are better than you, then mm-hmm. some of it's going to rub off.
Yeah, hopefully.
Yeah.
Find something you can steal from them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anything else you'd like to add? You're a fountain of knowledge, and it's we just have a moment to get a glimpse of that. Anything else you'd like to add?
Oh, I don't know. That pretty well covers it, except I still enjoy playing. I probably play usually 2-3 times a week with mm-hmm. different people, either at gigs or jams or whatever. I just love to play. You know.
Well, we're going to get a chance to hear you play here in just a couple of minutes here. So
okay.
We'll get some guitars together and see what we can work out. Thanks for coming down. Appreciate it.
Glad to be here.
Thank you. Thank you.
I left my home down on the rural route. Told my pa I'm going stepping out and get the honky tonk blues.
The honky tonk blues.
The honky tonk blues.
Got the honky tonk blues.
Cause Lord, I got 'em. Got the honky tonk blues. I went to a dance, wore out my shoes. Woke up this morning wishing I could lose the honky tonk blues.
The honky tonk blues.
Honky tonk blues.
The honky tonk blues.
Yeah, Lord, I got 'em. Got the honky tonk blues. I stopped into every joint in town. The city life has really got me down. I got the honky tonk blues.
The honky tonk blues.
The honky tonk blues.
Got the honky tonk blues.
Lord, I got 'em. Got the honky tonk blues. Got Wonder Bill. Right back to my pappy's farm and lose the honky tonk blues.
Got the honky tonk blues.
The honky tonk blues.
Got the honky tonk blues.
Yeah, Lord, I got 'em. Got the honky tonk blues. I don't want to be bothered with the honky tonk blues. Was in the spring. Sunny day, my good gal left me and went away. Now she's gone. I don't worry, cause I'm sitting on top of the world. She called me up from El Paso. Come back, baby, I miss you so. Now she's gone. I don't worry, cause I'm sitting on top of the world. You got one, Bill?
I don't worry, cause I'm sitting.
were dancing one night in Kentucky, beneath the beautiful harvest moon. And I was the boy who was lucky, but it all ended too soon. As I sit here alone in the moonlight, I see your smiling face, and I long once more for your embrace and the beautiful Kentucky walls. Night in Kentucky, beneath the beautiful harvest moon, and I was the boy who was lucky, 'cause it all ended too soon. As I sit here alone in the moonlight, I see your smiling face, and I long once more. Kentucky.